Hi students, welcome to CivilEd, an e-learning platform for civil engineering students. I am Professor SPN from CivilEd team. For complete information on pavement design, subscribe to our channel and watch all the lecture videos under pavement design playlist. In this video presentation, I shall present you the various design approaches in flexible pavement from the past decades. So, flexible pavement design methods. Since the past several decades, we have n number of design approaches being followed by various countries across the globe. So, all these design approaches can be broadly classified under the following headings. Firstly, we have the empirical methods. Second type, we have the mechanistic methods. And third, we have the theoretical methods. The empirical methods are those methods which are based on the past experience and experimentations or combination of both. In these methods, only the physical properties of pavement materials and traffic loads parameters were considered for design. Continued and a modified form of empirical methods are the semi-empirical methods, wherein in addition to the parameters mentioned in empirical methods, the stress strain behavior of the materials due to applied loads are also considered and modified based on experience. During the past recent years, in some of the countries, mechanistic design approach based on the mechanics of pavement materials, such as strength characteristics due to varied load, are studied under mechanized pavement model, and the pavement response is then understood for upgrading the pavement materials in terms of materials and construction methods. Next, we have the combination of mechanistic and empirical methods, wherein the strength characteristics are improved by mechanistic approach and the performance studies are carried out that relates to empirical methods. The theoretical methods comprise of understanding the theory by analyzing thoroughly, supported by equations and mathematical computations. Moving on, let's look into the advantages and limitations of the various design approaches. Firstly, the empirical methods have the following advantages. The design charts prepared by the researchers for flexible pavement design are presented in very simple form that is easy to understand and use by any individual with a minimum knowledge on pavement engineering. These design charts are based on vast experience from decades and hence gives us confidence for adopting them. These design methods are also based on the field performance of the pavements. The limitations of the empirical methods are these design methods are prevalent only to the region of study. The variation in soil properties, traffic characteristics, climatic factors, etc. in different regions is not given due importance. So, it is not desirable to use the same set of design charts in any other region. Along with this, utmost caution is to be exercised while making use of the design charts in the new location. Next, let's look into the advantages and limitations of mechanistic methods. the material properties and the application of loads on pavement layers are mechanized and considered in the studies and are incorporated in the design. The stresses, strains, and deflection determined by mechanistic approach for design. The mechanistic methods has provision for changing the load types and the frequency of loads, and the response of the pavement is studied for such variations. The material characterizations that are followed in mechanistic design methods, they allow the following, that is, better utilization of the available materials is possible by adopting mechanistic design approaches. Accommodation for new materials is given away. An improved definition of existing layer properties can be defined. And further, we can relay the performance predictions. That is, we can predict what happens under all these set of conditions to happen in the same way in the field conditions also. Further, it accommodates environmental and aging effects on materials also. So these are the good number of advantages under mechanistic design methods. Moving on with the limitations of mechanistic design methods, we have the value of stresses and strains in the different pavement layers are tested under ideal or assumed set of conditions. These idealized conditions assumed, such as, for example, strain is directly proportional to applied stress, etc., may be applicable only for some of the pavement materials, that too only under certain specific conditions. The climatic and environmental variations are not easy to consider in mechanistic approaches. So we can observe, compared to empirical methods, these mechanistic methods have more advantages compared to their limitations. So they serve the purpose, that is, the mechanistic methods serve the purpose in adopting as flexible pavement design guides. Moving on, let's look into the various empirical methods available for flexible pavement design. So the first method, the group index method. In this method, if you recall the HRB classification, that is Highway Research Board soil classification, we find something called as a group index value for the subgrade soil. That value of the group index is directly used on design charts to obtain the thickness of the pavement in case of group index method. If we observe over here, this method considers only the subgrade soil parameters to arrive at the pavement thickness. So we can say that is the disadvantage, because it doesn't consider or doesn't take into picture the other layers of the pavement. Anyhow, these are just the glimpse of these methods, and in the further lecture videos we are going to take up this individually, this the design procedure, the way the design, the thickness design is arrived at. Those things we'll discuss in detail in the upcoming video lectures. Next, we have the California bearing ratio method. So in this method, the pavement layers considered for conducting tests and thereby knowing about their strength characteristics are the subgrade soil, subbase, and the base course. So on these layers, we conduct the CBR test, and thereby we get to know the strength of the pavement materials in each layer, and all these parameters are considered in arriving at the overall pavement thickness. Next, we have this California resistance value method. The pavement layer considered are subgrade soil, subbase, base course, and surface course. That is, all the pavement layers are made provision here. So the test is conducted by using these parameters. That is, a stabilometer is used here, a cohesiometer is used here, and the number of load repetitions that happen on the pavement layers is also considered. So the criteria that is addressed in this empirical method is strength of the pavement materials, equivalent load factors, and traffic range is considered in arriving at the overall pavement thickness. Again, I am telling you, these individual design methods will be dwelt in upcoming lecture videos separately, and we have to solve problems on each method also. Next, we have the McLeod method, and even this method considers all the pavement layers, that is subgrade soil, subbase, base course, and surface course. This method makes use of a test, that is repetitive plate bearing test, and the criteria that are addressed over here are the strength of the pavement materials and load repetitions criteria. So using these criteria, the thickness of the pavement is arrived at. So all these four flexible pavement methods are listed under empirical methods. Moving on further, we have semi-empirical methods. The example of design method that we consider under semi-empirical is the triaxial test method, which is a theoretical method using empirical modifications as suggested by Kansas State Highway Department. In this method also, we consider all the pavement layers, that is subgrade soil, subbase, base course, and surface course. The test used to identify the strength characteristics of individual layers is the triaxial test. The various criteria that are addressed are wheel load, contact area, traffic parameters, rainfall data, deflection values, and Young's modulus values of individual layers. So this is about the triaxial shear test method. Next, under theoretical methods, we have Burmeister's method, which is a two-layered system concept. This method considers all the four pavement layers, subgrade soil, subbase, base course, and surface course. The various criteria that are addressed over here are the stress distribution, the deflection criteria, the elastic modulus of pavement layers. Here we consider two pavement layers at a time and obtain the elastic moduli ratio of those two layers, and further we arrive at the required pavement thickness. We make use of what is called as the deflection curves given by Burmeister's method, and comparing with the elastic modular ratio with the deflection curves, we try to get the overall thickness of the pavement. With this, we have looked into various flexible payment design methods, that is empirical, semi-empirical and theoretical methods. Now let's look into the guidelines for the design of flexible payments as provided by IRC and the way of how it has been evolved from the past decades. The first edition of the IRC 37 was published during 1970. The parameters considered for the design are the subgrade strength and the traffic parameters. The subgrade strength was found by the CBR test. The traffic expressed in number of commercial vehicles per day. Next, the first revision for this IRC 37 was made during the year 1984, and the parameters considered were the same, that is the subgrade strength and the traffic parameters. But here the design traffic was expressed in terms of the cumulative number of equivalent standard axle load of 80 kilonewton. Along with that, the design charts were provided for the design traffic up to 30 MSA, that is million standard axle repetitions. Both these, that is the first edition and the first revision, was purely based on the past experience of the traffic flow on the pavements, and so we can consider these two as empirical methods. Moving on to the second revision of IRC 37 that was published during the year 2001, the parameters considered were the same, that is soil subgrade strength and the traffic volume parameters. Further, the traffic volume was divided into two categories, low to moderate and medium to very heavy traffic volumes. Based on this, two design charts were given, that is for arriving at the thickness, pavement thickness values, two design charts were given. First one, the design CSA values, that is cumulative standard axle values, varying between 1 to 10 MSA, and the second one, the design CSA values varying between 10 to 150 million standard axles. So based on these parameters, 9 different design curves were presented for the different CBR values ranging from 2 to 10%. Now let's look into the salient features of IRC 37-2001, that is the second revision. This was the first mechanistic approach guidelines from IRC. Of course, it was also based on past experience, and so it's termed as mechanistic empirical method. The second revision was actually a well-planned research output from the various research schemes undertaken by MORTH, that is the Ministry of Road Transport and Highways. Amongst all the research schemes, the schemes named R6 and R56 were mainly considered. Two mechanistic empirical performance models were studied, that is the subgrade rutting model and the bottom-up cracking model at the bottom of bituminous layer. Further, a software tool was developed which was named FPAVE, that was from R56 research scheme, for the analysis of linear elastic layered pavement systems, that was used for the analysis of pavements and for the development of thickness from the design charts. The design thickness charts were provided for design traffic levels up to 150 MSA. Moving on to the third revision of IRC 37 that was published during the year 2012, let's directly look into the salient features. The first salient feature is that the traffic volumes more than 150 MSA were considered. That is due to developments that had happened during the past decade and that demanded for movement of more freights. Utilization of new payment materials were made a provision. Utilization of new construction techniques and practices were bought in. Use of harder grade of binders was recommended. These recommendations were made for the use of hard grade binders, that is the binders with more penetration values to resist rutting and top down cracking in the upper bituminous layers. Two mechanistic empirical performance models were developed, that is a rutting model for subgrade soil and a bottom up cracking model in the bituminous layers were established for two different levels of reliability, that is at 80% and 90% reliability levels. Fatigue criteria were also included for cement treated bases, that is at the level of base layer itself the fatigue criteria was considered. IIT PAVE software were introduced to validate the pavement composition and derived pavement thickness, which are obtained from the charts. Further, let's look into the scope of the third revision, that is IRC 37-2012 version. See students, this revision has the vast set of guidelines which incorporated too many technology in terms of pavement layers and construction methods. So now let's look into these various types of pavement layers that are considered under this revision. So the first one, granular base and subbase. Secondly, it has incorporated cementitious base and subbases with a crack relief layer of aggregate interlayer. So you can observe here in this figure given. So we have all the pavement layers and the aggregate interlayer for cemented base, this is placed just beneath the bituminous layer, that is above cemented base and beneath bituminous layer. Cementitious bases and subbases with SAMI, S-A-M-I, that is stress absorbing membrane interface, S-A-M-I. It is either you can use an aggregate interlayer for cemented base or a SAMI layer. Again, it is in terms of gradation of aggregates. Next, the reclaimed asphalt pavement, that is you can use the existing bituminous pavements, that is it is scarified, and those small aggregates coated with the old bitumen will be utilized again. It will be embedded in the base layers and thereby you can recycle the existing bituminous pavements. So this provision is also made under this revision. Next we have the use of deep strength long life bituminous pavements and combination of all above. So these six various parameters are listed under the third revision of IRC 37-2012, and any of these layers can be utilized in the construction of pavement. Next, just let us just revise the new elements that are incorporated in the third revision. So this design period has given guidelines to have a design period of more than 15 years. The computation of effective CBR of subgrade for pavement design. So effective CBR is the CBR value of both the borrow material and the existing subgrade layer. So the in combination of those two, we take the effective CBR value. Use of rut resistant surface layer, okay, so in order to improve the durability. Use of fatigue resistant bottom bituminous layer, so this is again to improve the durability aspects. Selection of surface layer to prevent top down cracking. So what is this top down cracking? So if the crack begins on the top surface and it is going to prevail downwards, so that such a phenomenon is called top down cracking. And surface, different surface layers are given under this revision to so that you can just choose one of them for if this top down cracking is more phenomenon in any region, any given region. Use of bitumen emulsion or foam bitumen treated wrap in the base course, that is reclaimed asphalt, that's what I said in the previous slide. Consideration of stabilized subbase and base with locally available soil and aggregate. So this is in order to make use of the available locally available materials. We say marginal materials in anywhere in the vicinity of the construction of pavements. The soil and aggregate mixtures available can be used, can be stabilized and used. Stabilization can be done by two methods, that is mechanical stabilization and chemical stabilization. Next, design of drainage layer. Okay, so for the first time, this third revision has incorporated design of a drainage layer for on either side of the pavements and for cross drainage works. Computation of equivalent single load considering single axle with single wheels, single axle with dual wheels, and tandem axle and tridem axle. So these are the things which are incorporated, and at the end we have design of perpetual pavements with deep strength bituminous layers. Perpetual pavements means everlasting, so the design period or the design life of these pavements will be too high, and they will not require any maintenance or with minimum maintenance. So such pavements are called perpetual pavements. So all these are the new elements which you cannot see in the previous revisions. So these are the things incorporated in IRC 37-2012. So with this, we will stop this video lecture, and further in the upcoming video lecture, we will take up each flexible pavement design and along with a illustration problem, and we can solve that. For continued videos on pavement design, kindly subscribe to this channel, Civil Ed, and thank you.